In 1962, all of us, already in not at first time, became hostages of crazy ideas and plans of the just another one Kremlin dwarf. Russian ships are sailing to Cuba, loaded mainly with military technic, rocket, launch equipment and personnel of missile units. Tankers, with rocket fuel.
Offensive missile sites is now in preparation on that imprisoned island.
The U.S. Navy escorts Russian ships to Cuba, while the Air Force flies around.
Capability against the Western Hemisphere. Only last Thursday, as evidence of this rapid offensive buildup was already in my hand,
in some cases, the decks are empty. It only means that all the equipment was concealed in the holds. Soldiers and officers were also placed in the holds. However, the cylindrical rocket hull with a size of over 20 meters was not possible to load into the hold through the hatches without the danger of serious damage to both the hull and the internal structures of the rocket. Therefore, the rocket hulls were loaded directly onto the open deck, covered with wooden shields on top, or simply left uncovered.
Acting therefore in the defense of our own security and of the entire Western Hemisphere, and under the authority entrusted to me by the Constitution, as endorsed by the resolution of the Congress, I have directed...
Upon arrival in Cuba at the destination, the missiles were overloaded at often not quite equipped berths, and immediately transported to the locations for the launch positions. Cuba. Eight K-63 missiles on positions. Targets are objects in North America, the flight time to which is a matter of minutes. At the last moment, before the inevitable outbreak of hostilities by American forces against the Russians in Cuba, the Russians retreated. The crisis is over. The Kremlin removes missiles from positions in Cuba and sends them to new locations. And it is now the Baltics. The combat crew moves to the reserve launch position area. The 8K-63 missile is transported on a special trolley. The convoy is escorted by tankers, maintenance vehicles, and a rocket installer on the launch pad. The whole crew in gas masks and rubberized costumes. Upon arrival, the rocket is installed on the launch pad with the help of an installer. Then the rocket is refueled with liquid fuel components, the most voluminous is the oxidizer. The lower end of the rocket. There are four nozzles that end the exhaust section of rocket engines. The top end of the rocket. Among other elements, a special place is occupied by a red fist in the very center. Its purpose is that when the head part is undocked from the spent missile body, this fist imparts an additional kinetic shock pulse to the head section, and starts the program for blast the nuclear warhead. Routine checks and maintenance work with onboard equipment. Preparation of the rocket for the launch in the ground version. Filling the rocket with fuel components successfully completed. Fueling hoses undocked. The remnants of the components are merged back into mobile tanks, and the tankers leave for the shelter area. The result of long hours work of the crew is the start. The rocket leaves the starting position normally and rushes to the target. The counter on the screen does not at all reflect the actual preparation time of the rocket for launch. Actual standards of the timeline for preparation and launch, a higher state of readiness, the time to start 140 minutes, the first stage of readiness 60 minutes, and finally full, 20 minutes. The mine installation for the launching the rocket 8K63, with the nuclear warhead of the 2 megaton trotyl equivalent. On these pictures are shown the schematic drawings of the whole mine complex, command bunker in the middle and 4 mines on the perimeter. The plan of the rooms, the command bunker. Simplified scheme of 8K63 in the mine. Detailed drawing of the 8K63 installation in the mine. Diagram for connection the fueling hoses of fuel components in the mine. The transportation of the nuclear warhead of the rocket 8K63. The warhead always transported separately from the rocket's hull. On such a transporter, the warhead being delivered to the start position. The warhead is connected to the rocket hull before installing the rocket on the launch pad. Scheme of installation of the rocket 8K63 in the mine on the launch pad with the help of the installer. A snapshot of the real installation of the 8K63 rocket into the mine. The installer, as it were, tumbles down the rocket above the mine and then smoothly lowers it onto the launch table. The rocket in the mine on the launch pad. Mine's cover is open. At the exit of the underground command bunker. Underground command bunker. Command control room. From here the officers remotely carry out routine inspections of onboard equipment, rocket preparation for launch, and launch the rockets. This video shows the work of officers at the command post of the mine variant 864. The interior of the room is somewhat different from 8K63, but the atmosphere and set of instruments are about the same. Communication between the central command post and the commanders of offices at workplaces in the mine and combat posts in the rooms of the command bunker is carried out by means of a combined headphone and laryngophone communication. Communication devices. Aviation helmet with headphones built into it for receiving messages and commands, laryngophone for transmitting commands and messages. Remote control of the fueling the missiles with fuel components. In practice, the fueling process, especially the oxidizing agent, could not be performed fully remotely due to the low reliability of the fueling system itself. The whole process was divided into several stages. 5-minute fueling, followed by stopping and checking the docking stations for leaks. 10-minute fueling with stopping and checking docking stations for leaks. And so until all leaks are eliminated. After successfully completing all the countdown operations, the key is set to start. rocket successfully left the mine and headed to the target. In 75 kilometers from Klaipeda, is located the one secret Cold War facility, underground nuclear rocket complex Dvina. Here in the mines were the rockets with nuclear warheads, capable to destroy any city within a radius of more than 2,000 kilometers. After closing in 1978, the complex was very soon totally plundered. But after a while here was created by the effort of volunteers and enthusiasts the Museum of the Cold War. Massive reinforced concrete covers are almost tightly closing the mines. The entrance to the underground command bunker. The entrance is closing by the massive steel door. The reconstruction of the interior of the central command post. The real view of the central command post. The room of the main switchboard. The switchboards for the mine's power supply, and the panel of connection to the external power line. Room of diesel generators station, the remained intact details of the main diesel engine of the 630 kilowatt generator are visible. Behind the remained intact foundations of small generators, 100 kilowatts each, is seeing the entrance from the room of the main switchboard. Here was placed the tank of the oxidizer. From the lowest level of the command bunker diverge by four rays the tunnels to the mines. The top level of the mine. Here were placed the auxiliary devices, the winches for the mine's cover moving, elevator control panel, and others. The view from inside of the mine to the mine's cover and partly to the interior of the mine. Inside of the mine is placed the steel cartridge. On the different levels of the mine are there the doors through the cartridge. Through these doors carried out the pre-start routine maintenance for the rocket's aggregates and devices, rocket engines, and control devices. Down below is seeing the launch pad. Mine's cover and external devices of the head of the mine. Everything looks still quite nice. Entrance to the underground command bunker. the external steel door at the entrance to the bunker. Behind this door, in the inside of the bunker, was installed the main steel door up to half a meter thick with mechanical dogs and ceilings. The outer staircase is not destroyed yet. The covers of the mines, once securely covering the rocket mines, are half destroyed by time and all kinds of diggers. And even so, they are still impressing by their massiveness. The entrance to the underground command bunker. The staircase leading down to the entrance is completely destroyed. All doors are dismantled and removed. Bunker. View of the premises directly after the entrance. Bunker. The premise of diesel generators. At the bottom left, is seeing the door from the premise of the main switchboard. On the walls are still yet readable the safety instructions. Bunker. The premise of the main switchboard. On the posts were laid steel decking, under which was performed the entire cabling. On the walls behind the panels of the main switchboard are also still yet visible the fragments of a single line diagram of the sections of the main switchboard, and instructions of electrical safety. The premise of the main switchboard. Remote alarm and control of the ventilation system of the entire complex. Bunker. Lower level. A room with a semicircular bed under the tank with one of the main fuel components, the oxidizer, the lowest level of the bunker premises. The furcation of tunnels 14 and 11, which are following in the mines number 4 and number 1. On the opposite side the same furcation of tunnels 12 and 13, which are following in the mines number 2 and number 3. The premises of the mine head and the mine itself. Light enters through the holes in the body of the mine and in the construction of the cover. Around garbage and rubbish, the hanging pieces of torn metal structures and steel reinforcements. All mines are almost completely flooded by groundwater. Around is the darkness and desolation. On the picture are seeing the remains of the shackle ladder. The shackle ladder during the time when the complex was in service. Steel cartridge inside of the mine. The following pictures can give an idea of the feeling of horror in times when the mine was in service. Absolute silence. Pitch darkness, which was broken only by the faint light of special refractory lamps, not densely located around the perimeter of the cartridge to all its depth. The light hardly making its way through thick blue glass lampshades. And the closeness of the ominous nuclear warhead of 2 megatons trodel equivalent. On the left is seeing the exit door to the grating lane around the cartridge in the top of the mine. Along the perimeter of the head of the cartridge between the steel cartridge and the walls of the mine was a grating lane. Below to the left is the exit to the mine from the elevator to one of the sites for rocket maintenance. Near the door, across the entire height of the mine, is a shackle ladder, enclosed by the metal barrier. It was possible by means of this ladder to get out from the depths to the top in case of an elevator malfunction. The remains of the elevator. The ladder, the grating door of the elevator cabin, the elements of the elevator control. The remains of the former boiler room. In the foreground is a round brick foundation for a steel 25 meter pipe, once standing on it. Not far away, behind the boiler house, there was a building of a garrison autonomous power station with three diesel generators of 100 kilowatts each. The former garrison bath and a number of concrete storage rooms, deepened into the ground. Two soldiers' barracks. In the first lived the first and the second companies. In the second, the guards and the service platoon. The building for training the personnel. Inside of the former officer's eating room. The remains of the motor car park, from inside and outside. The building of the guardhouse. Directly to the building of the guardhouse building were a joint system of wire barriers and other alarm devices of protection of launch positions on all perimeter. Summer of 1989. I'm driving home. Inside of the car is silently working the radio. is sounding the unobtrusive music. And suddenly I hear, in the Aluxn area of Latvia is closed the former nuclear rocket base. Wow, this is my base. I served there from 1963 until 1966. The story is over. On the place where once was the very secret military object now remain the dismal ruins. And what will be there after another 10 years? And will somebody remember about it? And is there what about to remember?